She said it was, she wanted to punish me, but it was too funny. I was punishing myself.
Oh, it's time.
Okay, all right, folks. Good evening and welcome to our Albany City Council meeting. And I'll call the meeting to order. Would you like to join us in the Pledge Allegiance to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Hey, Mary, could we get a roll call?
Olson.
Here.
Collins.
Here.
Johnson.
Here.
Killam.
Here.
Kupczynski.
Here.
Coburn.
Here.
Okay, scheduled business this evening first is on page 3. This is accepting resignation from Debbie Berg from the Human Relations Commission. Council, what would you like to do?
I move that we accept the resignation and send her a letter of thanks for serving.
Second.
Right, any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Okay, motion carried. All right, next is a quasi-judicial public hearing. And this one, actually, we did have this last month, so we've kind of continued this public hearing and kind of reopened it. So this is CP-0114 and CZ-114, request for a comprehensive plan map amendment to change the designation of one parcel from the low-density residential and general commercial to the medium-density residential designation, and change the zoning from single-family residential RS-6.5 and community commercial to the residential medium-density attached district. The applicant is R.J. Aldrich, represented by Rich Catlin with Reason Associates. The location of the proposed zone change is 241 Waverly Drive Southeast. I call to order this quasi-judicial public hearing at 7:17 p.m. If you wish to testify, please sign in at the table next to the meeting recorder. And do any members wish to declare a conflict of interest, any council members? Okay. Do any members wish to report any ex parte contact? And do any members wish to report a site visit? Bill?
I drove by the site the other day down Waverly and Salem, back in on Lake Street, and didn't get out of the car, but just looked around.
Okay.
Okay, Bill. I also just drove around through the neighborhood over the weekend.
Oh. Times three.
Okay. Okay. Four?
Yeah, I drove by.
I don't.
Okay, goodbye. Okay, looks like everyone did. So, yeah, almost. Okay. Do any members wish to abstain from participating in the proceedings? Okay. Does anyone wish to challenge the City Council's right to determine this matter or the participation of any councilor in this hearing and decision? So, yes, sir, you do? Okay.
Want me to get into the microphone?
Okay, you're going to have to come to the microphone. And this is more challenging our right to make the decision is what the question was.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Could you state your name and furnish your address and spell your last name for me, please?
My name is Michael DeRusha, and that's D-E-R-U-S-H-A. Okay. And I'm at 2617 4th Avenue, which is right across the street in the H-shaped building.
Okay.
And I would just like to ask Councilwoman Johnson about her husband's construction company, if there be any involvement.
No, not that I'm aware of, no.
Okay. That was the only question.
Oh, okay, yeah. Or her husband doesn't have a construction company.
There's so. Larry Johnson Construction.
Yes.
Yeah,
so you're listed as one of the officers in the corporation.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, okay. All right.
Thank you for asking.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone else wish to challenge the City Council's right to determine this matter? Okay. All right. For all those wishing to testify, please be aware that you must raise an issue with enough detail to afford the council and parties an opportunity to respond to the issue if you later want to raise that issue on appeal to the Land Use Board of Appeals. Testimony and evidence must be directed towards approval standards staff will describe or other criteria in the comprehensive plan or development code that you believe apply to the decision. If additional documents or evidence are provided by any party, the City Council may allow a continuance or leave the record open to allow the parties a reasonable opportunity to respond. Any continuance or extension of the record requested by the applicant shall result in a corresponding extension to the 120-day limit. Failure of the applicant to raise constitutional or other issues relating to proposed conditions of approval with enough detail to allow the local government or its designee to respond to the issues precludes an action for damages in circuit court. Okay, at this time, I call for the staff report. Okay, David?
Hello, I'm David Martineau. I'm a planner here at the City of Albany. And I will just summarize the request here briefly. R.J. Aldrit, represented by Rich Catlin of Recent Associates, has applied to change the comprehensive plan designation of a 1.38-acre lot from low-density residential and general commercial to medium-density residential, together with a concurrent zoning map amendment that would change the zoning of that property from RS 6.5, which is a single-family residential designation, along with community commercial, to residential medium density attached. Mr. Aldrit's property is located at 241 Waverly Drive Southeast. The Planning Commission held a public hearing regarding this proposal on April 20th, 2015. The Planning Commission found that the proposed comprehensive plan map and zoning map amendments are consistent with the city's comprehensive plan policies and the Albany Development Code review criteria. These criteria are addressed in detail in the staff report included in your packets, and based on these findings, the Planning Commission voted 6-2 to recommend that the City Council approve the proposed comprehensive plan map and zoning map amendment. The City Council considered the proposed amendment during a May 27, 2015 public hearing. However, there were not enough votes to make a decision on the draft ordinance that would approve the amendment. The ordinance was presented again for council consideration during the council's June 10, 2015 regular meeting. Prior to taking action on the draft ordinance, a member of the public requested that City Council reopen the public hearing to consider new testimony prior to making a final decision. The City Council granted this request, therefore, staff is presenting the draft ordinance again for your consideration at tonight's hearing.
Okay, all right, any questions of David? Okay, thank you. Okay, so now we will take testimony from the applicant.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the council. My name is Rich Catlin, land use planner with Recent Associates, representing the applicant R.J. Aldrit on this application. You've had an opportunity to review the information presented at the last hearing and also the information, the recommendation from the Planning Commission. I'll just cover a few notes and then I have a short slideshow. Just as a reminder, within a 300-foot radius of the Aldrit property, there are 59 dwelling units on 6.5 acres. That works out to a density of about 9 units an acre, greater than a single-family zone. This is a 1.38-acre parcel. It's an odd-shaped parcel. I've described in some detail how difficult it is to develop it as a single-family subdivision. And we feel that the RMA zoning provides a more efficient way to develop the site. The RMA zone is considered a transition zone from commercial areas to residential areas. This property borders commercial zoning along Pacific Boulevard, and then on the other side it borders residential zoning. The need for this type of zoning has been demonstrated in the Albany Housing Needs Analysis, which identified a shortfall of 44 acres in this zoning designation and a surplus of 321 acres for the zoning designation that's presently on the property. So the zone change would be a step forward in meeting that housing demand. There was a traffic impact analysis that was conducted for this application. It was reviewed by ODOT and city staff, and both agreed that the application meets their requirements. To sum up, this is a small project. It integrates into the neighborhood because it's not strictly a residential neighborhood. It's an edge development. There's residential on one side, there's commercial on another side. It's not like we're requesting RM zoning in the middle of a residential neighborhood. That's not the case. It's in between residential and commercial. And in that way, it's like the Woodwind Apartments project on Old Salem Avenue, which has residential on one side, busy street on the other side. And that's a larger project. That's 2.19 acres. This is a little bit more than half that size. So smaller project, similarly situated to the Woodwind Village project. With that, I'll just jump to the slideshow. So the question of compatibility with adjoining residential has come up. So what I wanted to do is graphically and in pictures try to remind you of the situation out there. In the lower left-hand corner is a map showing the Aldrich property in orange, and to the north of that is the Tegner property. You received testimony last month from Casey Tegner, so I just wanted to use her property as an example of how the Aldrich property could develop. So there are two photos of the Tegner property, one from directly in the middle of the lot, one from the southwest corner of the lot. You then translate that into a cross section across the frontage of the Waverly Drive. This is a, as best I could, scale illustration of the, I can't do that. The Tegner property is the largest, the tallest structure, the residence itself. There's a wing to the left in the back. Off to either side, there are small accessory buildings. If you then expand the cross-section to add the Aldrich property, the Tegner property is about 90 feet across, and Aldrich is about 176 feet across. And just as a reminder, comparing the setback restrictions in the two zones, RS 6.5 has a 5-foot setback for a one-story structure and an 8-foot setback for two or more stories, with a overall height limitation of 30 feet. In the proposed RMA zoning, the interior setback has two different setbacks depending on the adjoining land use. If it's adjoining residential, it's 1-foot setback for 1 foot of 1 foot of wall height, and if it's adjoining commercial, it's 10 feet of setback plus 3 feet per story over three stories with a maximum height of 60 feet. What does that look like on the ground? On the Tegner side of the proposed zoning boundary, you see the 30-foot height limitation and 8-foot setbacks if a two-story structure was built there. On the RM side, there is the graduated one-to-one for every foot away from the Tegner property line. The building height is limited to 1 foot in height, so there's a 10-to-10 grid laid out to show what that means. And then on the other side, where it borders the commercial zone, it would be approximately a 16-foot setback. So then a few hypotheticals. If the Tegners, just for argument purposes, wanted to replace their existing residence with a house, a two-story house, the maximum height would be 30 feet. If Mr. Aldrich wanted to divide his property as a residential subdivision and build a two-story house on it, if he wanted to develop a two-story apartment building on his setback would be 32 feet away from the Tegner from the Tegner house. So here's a zoom in showing the differences in the two setbacks. Much has been made about privacy, security, and that kind of thing, and people living in apartment buildings staring down from two stories at the nearest residence. Well, you can see from this that it's about 40 feet away for a two-story residence. If the Aldrich property stays RS 6.5 and he builds a residential subdivision on it, he could place a two-story residence within 8 feet of the property line, much closer than a 32-foot setback for a resident apartment structure. The development code contains a set of design standards for apartment, for multifamily developments, and one of those is that wherever you have a space between the property line and a building, you cannot use that space for parking, maneuvering, driveways, recreation areas, loading, that kind of thing. So that restriction's in place to guarantee the security and safety of neighboring properties. And those, just as a moment, the design standards in the development code were generated in 2001 as part of the Great Neighborhoods Project, where the city had a conversation with various neighborhoods in the city to get some ideas on what we could do, what the city could do to improve the livability of neighborhoods. And out of that came a set of design standards to improve the look and functionality of multifamily dwellings. And those standards were reviewed by the Planning Commission, adopted by the City Council, and have been in effect and in use since that time. So that would conclude my presentation tonight. I'd be glad to answer any questions you have.
Any questions?
Since that was so much material to run through, I also have a Cliff Notes version of it that I'll hand out.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Rich. Okay. And thank you for providing that exhibit. So. Okay, at this point then, we will provide testimony for in support of the application. I had quite a few people that had signed up that was for against. So for now, I will ask if there is anyone here that would like to speak in favor of this application. Okay, not seeing anyone. And so for opposition, I will start from the beginning of the list, and we have quite a few that signed up, so and if everyone does speak, you know, we might be here for a while, so the council's very used to, you know, hearing testimony, but you, please take into consideration that if you're one of the beginning speakers, some of the folks that are on the bottom of the list might be getting a little bit anxious to want to get up and speak. So maybe if you can try to refrain from repeating information that one of your neighbors have already, you know, spoke about. So, okay. And first we have Casey Tegner.
Hello, my name is Casey Tegner, T-E-G-N-E-R. I live at 221 Waverly Drive. I appreciate Mr. Catlin making this all about me, but it's not all about me. My neighbors would disagree that it's all about me and my house. My main arguments through this whole process have been impact on the neighborhood. It's a quiet, modest neighborhood. And traffic, noise, privacy, and property values have been my main points. Much has been made of this being a buffer zone between the general commercial and single family, and it would not be a buffer zone. It would overwhelm the neighborhood. It would allow building to nearly double the number of units for a three-block area, and nearly triple the number of units on Waverly Drive itself. This has all been based on a study that hasn't been updated since 2007. There's been a great deal of multifamily housing that's been built since 2007. This would be a minor tick in the checkoff box of how many acres are needed, and not a very efficient use. Mr. Catlin was also talking about efficient use. But efficient use isn't always in alignment with peaceful enjoyment of your property. And efficiency, I don't think, should be our main concern here. At least, it's not our main, my main concern. The neighborhood is turning around. We have more and more people moving in, buying houses that have been foreclosed on, and updating them, pouring lots of money into renovating these houses and bringing this neighborhood back up to snuff. But this neighborhood has been in existence for more than 60 years in its current state, and we like it that way. And I guess, you know, I don't want to keep repeating because I know my neighbors want to talk too, so that's all I have.
Any questions, Casey?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next is Sherry, or Cherie, or Sherry Wellens. And if you can also spell your last name, furnish your address.
I can't. My name is Cherry Wellens.
I was way off.
W-E-L-L-O-N-S. My last name's pretty simple compared to my first one. Boy, address. My main concern about this proposed zone change, there are several, and one of them is traffic. I often ride the city bus, and there's a bus stop down on Salem and Waverly, Salem Avenue and Waverly. And I have observed the traffic, particularly in the morning commute, and it isn't pretty. It's kind of sad already. And the idea of having a potential apartment complex or something else on that lot is pretty scary for just the traffic concern alone. Also, parking. I live right across the street from the property at 300 Waverly Drive, and you know, just considering the possibility of having added people parking in front of my house, and that's a big concern, and it would definitely interfere with garbage pickup, street sweeping, and it would limit visibility for backing out onto the street, because I also have to back out onto the street from my driveway. And these things I find to be quite concerning to myself and then our other neighbors also. And also, even looking at his diagrams, indicated that the driveway for this property would have to be moved, which more than likely is going to put it almost directly across the street from my house. And the idea of having cars pulling in and out of there at various hours of the day and night, particularly in the hours or in during the months when we have during darker periods of time, like during the winter months when it's darker during the day and night, there's going to be headlights, you know, shining, coming out of the property. And it is not a desired result on our behalf. So I have read some of the goals for the proposed change, and while I feel like that some of those goals are rather admirable, I don't believe this is the place to accomplish those goals. There are more suitable areas in our fair city. And also, one other thing is the added traffic is going to mean more street maintenance that will be needed, and it is already a problem in the city of Albany, and I don't even want to think about the potholes in my street. So thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Next is either Janessa or Vanessa DeRusha. DeRusha? Yeah.
My name is Vanessa DeRusha. I live at, or D-E-R-U-S-H-A. I live at 2617 4th Avenue, right across the street in the H apartments. My main concern is the crime rate that will go up with the population increase. Me and my husband used to live just south of the area in the Wedgwood apartments, and I came home one day to find our apartment broken into. It was the worst day of my life being taken advantage of like that. And we moved to this apartment feeling safe. I felt safe for the past year. I recognize everybody that walks up and down that street. and it's not going to be that way if this apartment's built. So that's all I have to say.
All right. Thank you. Okay. And Michael?
Hi again. Michael DeRusha, DERUSHA. I live in the apartments across the street, and I was born in Lebanon, but I've lived in Albany since 1970. My family's been here since the 50s, and frankly, any more building in this town to me needs to be looked at very, very closely, especially in regards to an open space, which this is. It's like a park over there, and there's plenty out of space out by where Kmart was. There's a huge flat piece of concrete. It's already, you know, it's already been flattened, and it's not going to take away any habitat or anything. There are about 57 properties within Albany that are offering rentals, so there's not really a housing need. We have 3,200 businesses operating, so adding another income source for someone out of town is really not in the interest of Albany. And that's all I have.
All right. Okay. Thank you. And next is Monica Weber.
Hi, my name is Monica Weber. I live at 210 Fulton Street. I want to thank you for giving the neighborhood residents another chance to voice our concerns about the zone change for the Waverly property. We know that you take the livability of the neighborhood, safety and traffic and infrastructure into consideration when you make your final decision on this issue. So I know you welcome our opinions and comments, the people who experience living in this neighborhood every day. My major concern about rezoning for higher density is the increased traffic, as has been spoken of previously. Large trucks, semis, not just pickups, barrel down my street daily. They choose Fulton rather than Waverly because either they don't want to wait at the light or they feel the turn onto Waverly is too tight for their large vehicles. In addition to that, all types of vehicles also use the same strategy to avoid the intersection at Waverly and Pacific Boulevard. With the potential for a large number of residential units added to the neighborhood, this situation will be exacerbated. Because it is difficult to turn left onto Pacific safely, I turn left at 4th and then right on Waverly so I can turn left at the light at Pacific. But traffic is often backed up on Waverly, several cars deep, making it impossible for me to turn right or left. How much worse will it become if there is a large apartment complex added to Waverly? Some traffic is to be expected living so close to a major street, and that was taken into consideration when we purchased our home just a year ago. We did not, however, anticipate a zone change in our neighborhood that would dramatically increase traffic along with noise, safety concerns, and pollution. I am an architectural drafter and designer, and I have worked with cities on behalf of my clients throughout the Willamette Valley on zoning issues for development. I get it. I'm not a no-growth advocate. I'm for smart growth and maximum livability, just like you. Please consider the residents of Waverly, Fulton, and Lake Street before you decide on the zoning change. Thank you for hearing me out.
Okay. Thank you. All right. And next is Carol Williams.
Thank you. I'm Carol Williams, W-I-L-L-I-A-M-S. I live at 240 Southeast Waverly, directly across from the proposed site. I'm not sure, but I may have been there longer than anyone, as I have lived in that house almost 40 years. We've defeated this, to my knowledge, twice before. The last time I was unaware of anything happening, I just found out about it when this started. And like everyone else, I'm sorry, I'm going to address the traffic. It's a very small street between two very busy streets, two major streets, and the traffic would be unbearable. We already have trouble getting in and out of our driveways. They would, there's one side parking, and their company, maybe if they have extra vehicles, would be parking on our street, in front of our houses, blocking our driveways. And that's all I have, is just the traffic part. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Carol. Next is Velma Johnston.
On Waverly.
Okay.
My name's Velma Johnston, J-O-H-N-S-T-O-N. I don't want to, like, just pound the traffic thing, but in 2 days, I won't be able to get out of my driveway to get either way on Waverly because it's all the way from the highway to Salem. And if you've ever driven down Waverly, you know how bad that intersection is. I have to slow down, veer to the right to get my car across there because I drive a semi-truck, I drive a truck. And you have to slow down to get on the intersection each time. And I just, I'm fortunate. I live in the H apartments that I have two parking spaces, so I can have a friend park behind me. But I'm the only one that has this. So if there are any extra parking spaces, they're going to be on Waverly or on 4th. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Next is Tom Glaudy.
Name is Glaudy, G-L-O-U-D-E. I live at 2045 Southeast 36th on the other side of town. We own a rental house at 139 Southeast Waverly. We're to the north of Miss Tegner's. Obviously, traffic is going to be a problem. We have both the city shops and Wa Chang funneling right down our street. I've lost many tenants. Tenants have moved out on me. They say they can't get out of the driveway. That's enough on traffic. Second, I mentioned this project to a couple developers, and they all expressed surprise that the council was even considering this because this would be considered spot zoning. In fact, I've got one realtor that has told me he hopes this will pass because he's got several projects he wants to bring in and have some spot zoning done on those projects. Thank you.
Okay. All right. And next is Janice Schmidtke.
My name is Janice Schmidtke. Thank you, Your Honor, for saying it right.
Oh, yeah. Butcher it. I got one right,
it's
yeah.
It's S-C-H-M-I-D-T-K-E. I bought my house about 6 years ago, I believe it's maybe seven, and I bought it for the sole purpose of the quietness that's there. I live at 230 Waverly Drive, directly across the street from this property. I know everyone has talked about the traffic problem, which is a nightmare. I've backed out of my driveway so many times, and I've had people come down from San Am barreling down through, and I don't know how many times I've darn been rear-ended. And then they get rather crude about it when they have to slow down. And I've seen people go from Salem to Pacific barreling down that road. I'll bet they were doing 40, 45, and I've seen motorcycles pop wheelies in front of my house down to Pacific. Kids, they don't have a prayer. Absolutely none. And it scares me to death. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you. And next is Pam Briggs.
My name is Pam Briggs, B-R-I-G-G-S, and I live at 197 Lake Street, to the rear of the proposed property. So my concern is that if the proposed zoning change is approved, it's going to have several negative impacts on all of us that live in the surrounding area. And there really isn't any positive impact that I have been able to see. The residential neighborhood in this area is primarily one-story single-family homes with a few duplexes and small single-story apartments. I can probably count on one hand the number of two-story homes in the area. Changing this lot from low-density to medium-density residential will have a significant negative impact on the neighborhood. The developers designed a site plan, which while it isn't official, it does give a good idea of the desired project. It seems clear that they're considering 25 to 35 two- or three-story apartments for this lot. Housing units of this type are totally out of character for the surrounding homes and would result in apartment residents being able to look out their windows into the front and backyards of nearby homes. The quiet family feel of this neighborhood would be lost. This lot has many tall, healthy, and beautiful trees. A medium-density zoning change would in all probability result in the loss of most, if not all, of those trees to allow for the construction of that many apartments. Right now, from my front window on Lake Street, I have a clear view of the back of this property and its beautiful trees. I regularly watch great blue herons, osprey, red-tailed hawks, and even bald eagles land in them. As a tree city, this is one of the things I appreciate being able to watch in Albany. Again, based on the hypothetical site plan, it appears that all or most of those trees would be cut down. If that happens, the view from my front windows would instead be multiple two- or three-story apartments looking into my yard and the yards of my neighbors. The traffic impact, I'm going to mention it briefly, will also be huge, not just for those on Waverly or Fulton, but for Lake Street as well, because the traffic on Waverly is so bad that even I avoid driving on it, and I will take one of the side streets when I need to get onto Pacific. Adding a potential 35 to 60 cars going in and out of onto Waverly at least twice a day will make it even more congested. And the traffic impact will reach to Salem Avenue because those exiting the apartments will choose to travel onto Salem Avenue. That affects me because it will make Salem Avenue traffic heavier than it already is at Lake Street, which will make entering and exiting my really quiet dead-end street even more difficult and dangerous, excuse me, than it already is. This lot is a buffer zone between our quiet residential area and the neighboring commercial area. If the zoning is changed, it will no longer be a buffer. It will be an encroachment into our quiet, primarily single-story, single-family neighborhood. So a change in zoning to medium density doesn't provide any positive benefits for those of us living nearby. While I'm opposed to the proposed zoning change, I want to be clear I'm not opposed to the development of that property. Keeping it as a low-density residential lot would allow for this type of housing that would complement and fit in well with the neighborhood rather than distract from it. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Pam. Next is Paulette Buffington. Okay. All right. Thank you. And Ruth Dwyer. Okay. And Ray Dwyer?
That's me. Okay. I don't have anything at this point. Everybody is.
Okay. All right. Your names are for the record here as signed up. So, okay. And Mike Briggs. Okay. All right. Next is Dane Campbell. It's been okay. Wow. You guys are just really moving through on this. And next is, I can't read the first name, is Alfter?
Lola.
Lola? Okay.
My name is Lola Alfter, and I live at 215 Fulton Street, Southeast. Everybody's already talked about the increase of traffic, and I just would like to recap the negative effect, the possible negative effect on the property values. I've actually talked to a couple of appraisal companies, and there could be a negative effect on the property values, and that would definitely concern me. I just purchased my home 2 years ago. So I would like that to be taken into consideration, too. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Okay. Well, that was a big list of names, and boy, I commend you. I think that's the fastest we've ever seen for testimonies, so you were well organized this evening. But is there anyone else that didn't sign up that would still like to be able to testify in opposition? Okay. Nope. Seen anyone? All right. And is there any member of the audience that would wish to speak neither in favor nor in opposition to the application? Okay. All right. Does the applicant have any rebuttal testimony?
Thank you, Ms. Mayor and members of the council. I'll try to be as efficient with my testimony as the neighbors have been with theirs. I just want to address a couple points that were raised. The unanimous opinion is that there's going to be a lot of traffic. I would call your attention to the traffic impact analysis in your packet. On page 2, there is a comparison of trip generation that would occur, comparing what would be generated for a single-family residence subdivision with 6 units and an apartment with 35 units. In the trip generation rates, apartments generate fewer trips per day than a single-family home. So the amount of trips generated slides. The PM peak hour, which is the hour from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m., is usually the hour that's studied by traffic engineers, and that's the time frame that was reviewed by ODOT and by city staff. And by comparison, a 6-lot subdivision would generate 6 trips during that PM peak hour. An apartment complex of 35 would generate 22 trips. That's a difference of 16 trips, or about 1 every 3 minutes. Hopefully, 1 every 3 minutes is adequate time for traffic to clear in the neighborhood. Although I am sympathetic to the turning movements and that kind of thing, this project would be required to have on-site parking in the amounts specified by the code. Whether residents would park on the street would be their discretion, but there would be ample on-site parking for residents. There's no specific development plan yet. The request is only for the zone change. So there's no development plan, there's no developer, there's no builder. We don't know what the future holds as far as a specific development plan. To characterize the property as open space, well, there's one house on 3 acres. And any lot that's 1.3 acres, and any lot that's developed like that would have considerable open space. But remembering that even in the present zoning, this could develop as a residential subdivision, much of that open space is eligible for development. The trees are a good question. These are large trees. These are trees that the owner would not have arbitrary discretion to remove. There are requirements in the city code about whether or not trees can be removed, and that would be reviewed during a site plan review when one comes forward. Is this spot zoning? That's a fair question, because this would be the only property that's proposed for the zoning. The counter is that if you look at the types of zoning in the neighborhood, it's in between two types of zoning. It's in between commercial and RS 6.5. If we were talking about a spot of RMA surrounded by RS 6.5, I would agree that's spot zoning. But since it's in between zones, I would argue that it's not spot zoning. That would conclude my comments. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Any questions? The applicant? Okay, Bessie?
I'm not exactly sure if it's Rich or if it's actually staff. It's to do with the parking, I'd say.
That's probably with staff then, I would think, over the parking question.
Yeah. Because you said there's no actual developer right now, so this is just a zoning change. But you say, keep saying apartment, and so I'm wondering, and I just wonder, how many parking spaces would be required so that they don't park on the street? Because that's a concern.
I think a staff question, and so this point would be is, does staff wish to respond to any of the testimony? So David, would you like to move forward and then answer Councilor Johnson's question?
And I even brought my trusty code book tonight.
Uh-huh.
So parking for apartments or multifamily residential, the It's calculated in a couple of different ways. First of all, each single-family residence in a residential zone is required to have two parking spaces. Now, if we're talking about multifamily, for each studio and one-bedroom unit, there needs to be one space per apartment unit, plus one visitor space for every four units. So our code actually does require parking not only for the residents, but for visitors to the complex. If the apartments are two-bedroom units, then it needs 1.5 spaces per unit, plus that same one visitor space for every four units. If the unit is three or more bedrooms, then each of those units requires two spaces per unit, plus one visitor space for every four units. So say you have a development in, you know, theory of, 15 two-bedroom units. Then it would need 22.5 parking spaces to accommodate those. Plus, it would be one visitor space for every four units. It would round up to about 26 parking spaces to accommodate that. And these are all off-street parking spaces.
Right.
Right on the development.
Yes. Do you think there'd be enough room for that many?
Well, that's the thing. That's one of the self-limiting things about developing this property with multifamily residential, is that it's only so big. And yes. So to be able to accomplish the development for the dwelling units and the parking and the required open space, all of those factor into limiting just how many units you can really get on the site.
Thanks. That helps a little.
Any other questions of staff? Okay. All right, so with that, I will declare the public hearing closed at 8 p.m. And council, what would you like to do? I think you have a yellow sheet in front of you. There's an ordinance that's on page 6. But you have some choices there with the yellow sheet. Or do you have questions? Bill?
No question, just a comment. I wanted to compliment Pam Briggs for her testimony. I had a few items I wanted to bring up, and as she was speaking, I'm just checking them off, and I have nothing to add.
Okay. What would you like to do? Questions?
About the ordinance.
Okay.
Have we read the ordinance? Help me out, David. You were going through this, and you made several comments about presenting the ordinance. My recollection is the ordinance has been formally read once. Has it been read more than once?
No.
Just once? Okay.
It's not more than
then once. Then I'll read the ordinance. An ordinance amending ordinance number 4447, which adopted the City of Albany Comprehensive Plan map, and amending ordinance 4441, which adopted the City of Albany zoning map, adopting findings for property located at 241 Waverly Street, Southeast Linn County, assessor map number 11S3W5DD, tax lot 400, and declaring an emergency.
Move to read second time, title only.
That was the second time, then.
Okay. Move to adopt the ordinance.
Move to adopt. Okay, is there a second? Okay, I'm not seeing a second to adopt the ordinance. So
the motion dies.
Or do you want a second for discussion?
I'll move for second for discussion.
Okay, second for discussion. All right. Council, what would you like to discuss? Rich?
I have a couple of issues with this. When you buy something, I've been on the short end of a number of these conversations, and the conversation started with, gee, this is unfair, and it went to, well, Rich, when people buy a place, they have an expectation of a whatever it is when they got there, that you shouldn't have a business, you shouldn't have a yada, 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 yada. And I'm reminded of that. You're talking about people who bought in a single-family area with a single-family area next to them. I mean, if the argument that you shouldn't have a small business someplace because it would disrupt the aura of the neighborhood, it is, does it make a difference what disrupts it? That's an issue for me. I think people have a right to know what was there. Or they have a right to know what, what could be there, and that's what happened when they bought the place. If you've been there for 40 years, that probably didn't show up, because at that point, there wasn't the kind of zoning there, probably. But if you bought a year ago or 6 years ago, certainly there would have been. I'm inclined to deny this, and the reason I am is for that reason. Plus, here you have a whole bunch of people who don't know what it's going to look like. If they knew what it was going to look like, they might have a different opinion. But at this point, they don't know what it's going to look like. And for that reason, I would be opposed to this.
Any other comments, Bessie?
I know the issue of traffic came up a lot. I mean, I live on Geary Street, and trust me, there's no busier street than Geary Street, and you have to try to back out on that thing, and sometimes you back out and you have to go back in, then back three times before, because you're right, they go barreling down, even though it's 25 miles an hour. Most people just don't care about that. And so I think the traffic issue, it doesn't seem, between Salem and Salem Avenue on Waverly to Pacific is what, how many, is it like two blocks, three blocks? Does anybody know? That's what I was going to say, it's a long block, you know. And I kind of agree with Rich where when now that I find out that there's really no specific development planned, it's kind of like, well, we're just deciding on something that we don't know what it's going to be. I mean, as it goes through, if we went ahead and okayed it, yes, staff would go through any kind of a site plan and all this, and only what was allowable would go in there. But it's such a small lot, and I'm thinking, what could you do with that? I mean, I can understand wanting to build maybe multiple housing on that, but until we find out exactly what it is, it's kind of putting something on the neighbors that maybe, I mean, we don't even know what it's going to be. And so I'm kind of inclined. At first when I was going to say, yeah, we should do it, but the more I hear, the more I think, well, I think we need to know more. Maybe if you can do both at the same time, like, well, do the zone change plus
code allows this process. So we actually changed that years ago, and this was sort of when Helen Byrne Sharp was our community development director. We used to be able to see, actually in one hearing, annexation, zone change, site plan approval. Yeah. In one hearing, which was nice because then you got to see what was really being proposed. But remember, during our code change over the years, it's done as basically this is the process. Somebody can put in the zone change only and not not bring forward the application.
And this, to me, this is
if that's something, you know, we probably should look at if we're, you know, seeing that there's a lot of site plans that really, you know, the neighbors want to be able to see, we might need to change that process, but this currently is the process.
Right, and to me, it's not fair to Rich and his company because they want to do the right thing and they want to go on, but then it's not right to the neighbors because they don't know what's going in, and we can't, we don't know what we're voting on. Really? Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
It's been a long time since you had land use applications.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you guys are a little rusty.
It's been nice.
You need to be making your decisions focused on the criteria that are in the staff report. It is not a basis for denial lawfully that there's not an accompanying application for the ultimate development. Think back when you zone property throughout the city, for example. You zone a certain area for residential of a certain density. You zone other areas for commercial of different types. At the time you set those zonings, you don't know what will actually be built there. The zoning sets the parameters of what can be done by somebody who owns the land and wants to develop it. And so it is completely appropriate under the law for someone to apply to a change to their zone. Now that gives you the opportunity, when they don't tell you what they intend to do. You look at all of the uses that are allowable within that zone, and you might say, well, even though these six uses might be good, these other 10 uses that are allowable would not be compatible. And therefore, if they don't apply with a specific application in mind, I have to consider the full range of what is eligible. The other thing is, you also need to realize that even if one applies for a site plan approval at the time of a zone change, they can get the zone change, the site plan approval, and then choose not to develop according to that site plan approval. They could choose to develop with a different site plan later on, and they would be legally within their right to do it. So as difficult as it is, and I know sometimes the law makes you park your common sense, it seems like, but I'm just telling you that is the way you're required to do it in land use matters. You're looking only at the application that is before you, and you're judging it on its merits. So if the majority of the council would prefer to deny the application, the best course is the motion to tentatively deny and to direct staff to bring back findings that would support a denial decision. Now, it's always helpful to staff when you articulate your concerns in a general fashion. If you say, for example, traffic concern is your primary concern, or if you say, for example, the best way, anytime you have a comprehensive plan amendment before you, you have a lot of discretion. If the comprehensive plan allowed if the proposed zone was one that was permitted without a comp plan amendment, then we actually have sort of a burden to show why we are denying under the criteria of the code. In a situation where there is a comp plan amendment included, you have much broader discretion because there is not a right to develop in essentially violation of the comprehensive plan designation. So if you want to give staff general guidance on what kind of findings you'd like to see come back, I would encourage you to do that in your land use matters. The best thing to do, though, is listen to concerns, and the concerns lawfully have to be relevant to the criteria. For example, a concern that that it has been open space and that there are resources there is not in the criteria. And you can't make your decision lawfully based on non-criteria concerns. So again, if the majority, if somebody would like to make a motion to deny, do it with the tentative decision example that is in your packet. Staff will do their best to bring you responsive findings at your next meeting. Again, because there is a comprehensive plan amendment, you don't have a 120-day issue for this kind of an application. And forgive me for going on, but again, it's been a long time since we were routinely doing land use. And so I'm hoping that you'll understand my comments are intended to make this easier on not only this application, but others that will come up before you if development activity picks up.
So, Jim, so
what do you do with the motion?
You
still have to vote on the motion.
Well, you have a motion and a second, so you'll have to vote on that motion.
And then if it fails, then you can make another motion.
Right.
Motion for denial, or tentative decision. So,
You really can't amend an approval to a denial.
Right.
The motion on the floor is to adopt.
Right.
The ordinance, yes. So, Dick, you have comments?
I'd like to say back in the good old days when I was first on the council, back in the 70s, zoning consisted of single family, a duplex zone, and an apartment house zone. And then, of course, commercial and industrial. Well, now we have all kinds of zones. And when I first heard about this, I heard a medium density zone. I thought, well, that doesn't sound too bad. But when you look at it, you see it really zones for an apartment house. The building can be, I think, 60 feet high. And what can you have, 30-some units in that 3.7-acre spot? That looks like the good old apartment house zoning to me. So I tend to be opposed to the motion. I'm going to be opposed to the motion.
All right. Any more comments, or would the council like to vote on this motion? Okay. All right. And the motion
doesn't fit.
Yeah. The motion was to adopt the ordinance. So all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Okay, can we get a roll call?
No, I think it's appropriate.
Collins?
Aye. Yes.
No.
Kellum?
No.
Kropczynski?
Yes.
No.
Four no.
Okay, all right. Now, council, what would you like to do?
Move to adopt the item three to tentatively deny.
Second.
Okay, and...
You have to mention what the reasoning...
You do not, there's no requirement that you must do that. Staff is always grateful if you give us a guidance on the areas, the principal areas of concern. Then let staff prepare findings and conclusions addressing that area based on the testimony that was submitted.
I don't know how much direction staff needs, and part of the problem, as you mentioned, Jim, is the lack of experience on land use issues, you know, for quite a while on the council. I don't know if it's reasonable to ask staff, who heard the same testimony we did, to look at those items that are applicable. I mean, certainly traffic was one of those. You know, for me, I'm thinking of, you know, our great neighborhoods and livability and so forth, but I'm guessing maybe those are not issues that staff can consider when coming back with reasons to deny.
If I could make a suggestion, the comprehensive plan criteria, which is set forth at page 12 on the bottom of, bottom page 12, marked page 12 on the report, shows number one criteria is that the requested designation for the site has been evaluated against relevant comprehensive plan policies and on balance has been found to be more supportive of the comprehensive plan as a whole. I think that you're, from the comments that I've heard, I think you'd find that not to be the case. I think you are directing staff primarily to focus on that criteria and determine that to deny the comprehensive plan amendment because you do not find that multifamily housing is in fact more supportive of the comprehensive plan as a whole in this particular area.
So we're basically directing staff to in fact find a reason, a valid reason for denial, even though there may in fact not be one?
That's an argumentative question.
Yes, it is.
And I do think
I'm not going to answer it.
And I do think there's something to consider, too, is when we did our last updating of our map and we took the buildable lands inventory and we, you know, need, you know, what was the projection for the 20 years of what housing, what type of housing did we need from single family to, you know, multifamily to commercial, and that's how we crafted up the zoning map and got all that public input process. There has been changes made, you know, the past decade over our zoning. We have had a lot more multifamily complexes being built, and we even had a zone change for 127 unit one that was single family that went to multifamily in the South Albany area. So we're sort of getting off balance what we originally established because of the past decade. But when we established that map and the multifamily, we knew what X amount of multifamily we needed for the 20 years, but it wasn't to concentrate it all in one area of town. It was to make it more evenly throughout the community. So the more you keep adding zone change for multifamily in the one set between the freeway to the railroad tracks, is not balancing our community from the intent of that zoning map. So that is something to consider when bringing back the findings for this, is it's never intended to change a zoning map to be for one section of town. So that was originally to be more distributed.
And if I may, and Councilor Kropczynski, I didn't mean to, I just don't want to get into arguing on the assumptions in the question. But it appears from the prior vote that at least to a majority of the councilors present, they don't feel that the applicant has met the burden of proving that that criteria has been satisfied. And the burden rests with the applicant on a comprehensive plan amendment such as this. So one could argue, of course, either side, and people always do.
So do we have a motion with a second?
We do. Motion and second.
I'll call for the question.
Okay. All right. So this...
Yes.
Correct. Yeah. Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Okay, let's do a roll call again.
Folsom?
Yes, I think is the appropriate answer.
Collins?
No.
Johnson?
Yes.
Gillum?
Yes.
Kupczynski?
No.
Coburn?
Yes.
Four to two.
All right, motion carried. So that will come back to the council at either the next council meeting or following for the council to make a decision over the motion that was just made over tentatively. It would be for denying the application.
But the council has the authority to reverse their decision based on the findings. You're going to get a chance to look at the findings, see if four of you agree that those findings embrace the reason for your denial. If you say, I don't like that finding, or I want you to change it to something else, then you can wordsmith as you choose.
Right.
But we can't overturn the whole procedure here, I would think.
You can. You're making it...
Do we have to have a new hearing to consider the facts?
No.
No, council could still overturn that.
You're making a tentative decision. So it is not a final decision tonight, because you cannot make a final decision without findings and conclusions of law.
Okay.
And until those are before you, you can't make the final decision. If the council changed its mind, you can, of course, do that. I would caution the council, though, the hearing is now closed. It is unlawful for you to communicate privately with individuals on this matter. So no one in the audience should communicate with the council, because the hearing is closed, and it's not an opportunity for new evidence or new information to be submitted.
On this item.
On this item, of course.
Right.
Right. So, Jim, if somebody does have, who's not here or doesn't see the TV, if they do write us, do we just forward it to Marilyn or somebody?
Yes, so don't read it. As soon as you understand what it is they're talking about, disregard it and send it to Marilyn or to Mary.
Sounds good.
Okay, Floyd?
Just thinking about a little bit of history. When we were going through the process back in the early 2000s, we were running up against some very difficult decisions with single-family zoning up against either commercial or industrial. And that was the reason for contemplating transition zoning, to do that blending. And I think I remember one, Marion, out along Oregon Freeze Dryer and there, that people were very concerned that you build single family right up against commercial or industrial, and pretty soon, even though the commercial and industrial had been there prior to the single family, then the neighborhood gets all upset and they started complaining. They have complaints against the industrial properties, and we tried to take some action that would at least mitigate part of that. My concern in part is, I think transition zoning is a good idea. I think it protects both existing commercial and industrial, but it also protects some residential neighborhoods and provides that other alternative form of housing. You know, I'm just very concerned with the criteria. I think criteria is embedded in the code. I don't know how we're going to deal with that. I'll see when the findings come back.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Thank you, folks. Yeah, thank you. Okay. Next on the agenda is business from the public. Is there anyone here this evening that would like to bring an item forward? All right. Tom?
Sure how the process works. One of the next agenda items has to do with the...
Can you say your name and address for the record? Thank you.
Let's see. Tom Courtier, 2240 Northwest Park Terrace in Albany. I'm not sure how the process tonight is going to work regarding this first reading of the proposal to increase the privilege tax against the citizens of Albany. And are you going to take testimony during that time?
It's not a public hearing, so you can make comments now.
Okay.
If you wish.
I didn't know if I should wait till that came and what
no,
you were going to do.
A hearing.
So I'll make my comments now. That's fine.
Okay.
In the letter from Stuart Taylor to the council dated July 1st. The second paragraph, first one under background says the increase was recommended by the budget officer and approved by the budget committee to offset property tax lost to compression. I don't know who the budget officer is, but I have a question. Did the budget officer recommend any items to reduce the cost of city government? Perhaps you didn't hear that. If you guys want to chat, I mean.
No. Could you repeat your question, Tom?
Okay. Did the budget officer recommend any items to reduce the cost of city government?
So, with your question there, this was part of the budget committee process that we went through.
I didn't ask
and,
that.
And it was actually Wes Harris, the one, our city manager, that proposes the budget, who works with the finance director and with all staff in bringing forward that document.
And that's not my question. The statement here says that the increase was recommended by the budget officer. I'm asking the question, did the budget officer offer any type of cost reduction to reduce the cost of city government in that process?
There is always, every budget season we go through, staff is going through
to reduce costs. Was there a recommendation supplied by the budget officer to reduce the cost of city government?
There wasn't just that general that narrow question. So, but there was always cost.
So I'll take that as a no, because certainly if there had been a significant recommendation made to reduce the cost of city government, I would have read about it in the newspaper. I would have read about it on Hasso's blog. It would have been public knowledge because people would have said, hooray, they finally got it. So I'll take that answer as a no. The city receives currently and the numbers come from Stuart Taylor as of today, their annual unaudited 12-month totals. You may have already gotten this. The sales tax, called a privilege tax, that we pay into the city coffers for electric power, PP&L, the city takes in $2.329 million in a 12-month period. In a privilege tax, a sales tax related to natural gas supply, the city takes in $655,000 a year. A franchise fee for ROW carriers brings in $44,000. A franchise fee for the telephone brings in $99,000. A franchise fee for the garbage collection brings in $420,000. A franchise fee for cable TV brings in $590,000 every year. And by the way, that doesn't include, obviously, those are just taxes and fees, which are really nothing more than taxes. That doesn't include any motel lodging taxes, and we probably all say, well, that's all the outer towners and we don't care if they pay a tax or not. I think that's probably the case. So apparently you're not satisfied with $4.2 million going into the general fund from all of these businesses that we use and you tax. You're not satisfied with $4.2 million. Now you want another $930,000. I find that unbelievable. Where does it stop? I don't know where it stops. Mayor, you made a comment to me years ago that if I continue to do what we finally did with the initiative petitions, that all we'll do, Tom, is just keep raising fees.
Said that, Tom.
Yes, you did. At the Huacheng Aaron Arts Festival, I can give you the date. And that apparently is what's going on. And so I'm objecting to this new sales tax increase. Electricity is a requirement of life today. It's not a privilege. This proposal increases taxes that are regressive, and I'll use my definition of regressive, lest someone try to use their own. It hurts those people who are less able to afford it. That is a regressive tax. Oh, but it's only $2 a month, says the document. Listen, the Albany Democrat Herald article recently of the grandmother raising, I forget, two or three grandchildren, not having enough money to pay for the water that comes to her home. And so now they, all of them, go down to the Y and shower 3 days a week because they don't want to pay for the money. Pay money for the water that comes to their house. There are people like that in this community, and this kind of regressive tax that is proposed because somebody had a bright idea only to get more money. Apparently there were no ideas to reduce the cost of city government, but we always look for ways to increase the revenue. And then on top of that, I find that you use the emergency clause. Inasmuch as this ordinance is necessary for the immediate preservation of the public peace, health, and safety of the city of Albany. This existing 5% has been around since 1991, and now it's an emergency? You guys are playing games with that, and I know what the game is because I know how to read the ORS, and it's wrong for you guys to do that. You ought to be ashamed that you're doing that because you only leave certain avenues to pursue when you do this. So I would encourage you to vote no on this increase in sales tax.
Okay.
And that's all I'll say.
Okay. Thank you. Is there anyone else from
any questions? Thank you.
Anyone else from business from the public? Okay. Not seeing anyone. Next on the agenda, council, is a first reading of ordinance, and this is over the privilege tax. And this would be, would you like to have the first reading read?
An ordinance amending Albany Municipal Code, Chapter 3.04, Privilege Tax, Electrical Power and Light Business, granting an electrical utility franchise and general utility easement to Pacific Corp and declaring an emergency.
I would move that the ordinance be read a second time in title only.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Okay, then we can't do the second reading. All right.
One of the issues that, Madam Mayor, if I may, putting aside the questions that Mr. Cordier is raising, I would like to introduce Sean Kidd from my office, who worked with Jeff in hammering out the public utility issues on the franchise, particularly, as well as the general financial technical details. And I know Sean had a few things he wanted to say about that that I just assumed you heard now, and then when you have the next meeting, you can consider the merits of adopting the ordinance. Sean?
Thank you, and good evening, Mayor and members of the council. I briefly just wanted to say that I wanted to thank both Jeff Blaine and Stuart Taylor for the hard work on this new ordinance that we're going to adopt. Originally, me and Stuart began working on this, and we focused on the compensation, the timing, the duration, indemnification, and things like that when it came to this ordinance. But then when Jeff got to take a look at it, he picked up on a lot of things that had to do with public works that hadn't been considered in the past. And with his work, we spent about a week and a half negotiating back and forth with Pacific Corps on the public works part of this. And I think that with Jeff's hard work on this, he really put the city in a much stronger position than we were before, and puts us in a really strong position moving forward for the years to come. Now, I just wanted to take the opportunity to say thank you to both Stuart and Jeff for doing that. Thanks.
Madam Mayor.
Uh-huh.
I'm of 12 minds on this. I do have issue with the idea that it is kind of boilerplate for us to use the emergency clause when clearly there's no emergency on some of the things that we use it on. I mean, I know other places don't, other places do. I would ask, what is the emergency? And if, you know, it does make it, and then we're done with it. And you know. However, if somebody hears it for the first time and Hassel has not written anything about it, or there's nothing in the Democrat Herald about it, it doesn't bring up any thoughts to them until they hear that kind of stuff sometimes. So I think the original idea was an emergency clause for an emergency. And, you know, now, I almost voted yes, because Mr. Cordier came by my place and said that today. It was today or yesterday, or you know. And I was going to bring this up, and it now looks like I am hopping on Tom's bandwagon for, you know, this particular item. I was on the bandwagon before he brought it up, if there is a bandwagon, so to speak. But I think we need to give some serious thought. Is what was the intent of making the law so there would be time in between, and what was the intent of the emergency clause?
The intent of the emergency clause in this matter is to avoid lost revenue. Delaying this matter 2 weeks will cost approximately $37,000 that would otherwise be available for the general fund. And so the emergency, this ordinance was intended to take effect originally before the start of the new fiscal year. When we discovered that there were public works concerns about the nuts and bolts operation of the franchise over the next 10 years, we had to engage with Sean's assistance in some pretty intense negotiation to get those done. It's with some urgency then, we're now behind the eight ball by one council meeting in terms of getting it effective for the start of the fiscal year. Each delay costs, I think it's, was it $85,000 a month?
$75,000
a month. That's the emergency. I don't mean to try to assume that I know what Mr. Cordier is concerned about or thinks the ulterior sinister motive is, but I think he believes that it is precluding a referendum, and that's why there is an emergency clause, because that's why you would normally have an ordinance effective 30 days after its passage, is so that there's time to enact to, for citizens to try to refer the matter so that the ordinance doesn't take effect. In my opinion, this ordinance would not be subject to referendum anyway, because in my opinion, it is an administrative decision. It is not adopting a law of general applicability citywide. Mr. Cordier may disagree. But so there's nothing lost by adopting the emergency clause, and what's saved is $75,000 a month. That was the reason.
I would point out to you, I think there is something lost. And what is lost is, besides the money, it is the opportunity of a group of people who may not agree with whatever it is to come here and beat on their counselor so it may not happen. I mean, I think that is what is lost if you...
I'm not trying to get into the philosophical thing. You just asked the question of why was there an emergency clause? And the reason there was an emergency clause put on the ordinance by staff was because in your budget you had already assumed that you were going to have this revenue.
My point is that we use this as boilerplate. Almost everything we pass via the emergency clause. And to my way of thinking, that isn't the way it was originally designed, and I'd like to know why we do it that way, other than the fact that it's easier.
And if I may, and I think you're absolutely right, and it has been, I have brought it up at a staff level many times, do we need an emergency clause? Why are we putting in an emergency clause? What I would urge the council to do in the future, and I'm not trying to be critical of anybody here, but what I would urge you to do is before you vote, if one of your concerns is about an emergency clause, while the matter is under discussion, ask staff to justify it. And if you aren't satisfied that there's a reason to act promptly at that night, then don't do it. You can easily amend the ordinance to extract the emergency clause, and then by operation of our charter, it'll take effect 30 days later. So there's nothing wrong with you putting staff on the spot and asking us, why is there an emergency clause recommended? We'll give you the reason. If you don't think it's a good enough reason, take it out.
Which we could have done at the work session when we were first getting information about this.
Right, or you could do, yeah.
Right.
And but I think, Councilor Kellum, I think your general comment is well taken, that from time to time we get in the habit of putting it in when we don't always need to. And what will cure us of that is a councilor asking us at the meeting, why is that there? And we have to have a pretty good reason. And we'll do it. And if you aren't satisfied, then take it out.
And also with these franchise fees, I did want to kind of clarify in case anybody is viewing the tape, is this is all utilities placed in the public right-of-way. So it's the people of Albany's property. So you're charging a fee for using the people's property. And it's for business, because the business is using that property. And not everybody accesses all the utilities, you know. So, you know, you're allowing the businesses to have that privilege to use the public land to make their profit. So franchise fees have been in place for many years. As you've noticed, we have not raised that percentage up. So we've really absorbed a lot of cost of living increases over the years as a city. And also there's a lot of declining revenue with some of the utilities that we have found too, mostly with the telephone, because there's not as many landlines as there used to be. So this is an issue not just with Albany over these declining revenues, but with almost every city in the state because of the limitations that cities can have for be able to bring in revenues. And as you know, our property taxes, 100% or more, only covers police and fire. So this is a big piece to be able to support, you know, parks and libraries and planning and senior center or pools, everything that we provide for city services. This is a big funding piece for it. And then you did adopt the budget, which was including this increase, which was a big piece of the budget. So this is something just to kind of take into consideration that that decision was pretty much made at that budget committee level. Okay? Anything else?
Well, I just wondered, it was already in the budget, but we hadn't approved it. And so I'm trying to to get it in my mind here, did we know that we hadn't approved it? Or was it already included in there and just a line item?
It was brought to the Budget Committee and showing for the Budget Committee to agree upon moving forward with this increase, and they adopted the budget. Budget Committee plus the Council adopted the budget knowing this increase would be in place.
I know we adopted the budget, but I mean, did we actually address this one little issue?
Yep.
Did we?
Yep, we did.
I know that this has been a city manager concern or issue for quite a while, that...
I mean, I just missed a budget meeting. That's probably the one that guys discussed it in.
I think it was actually pulled out of the meeting that was supposed to be approved, like the council meeting approved, because of the issue that was discovered that Jeff was working on to put the city in a better position. That was the only reason it was pulled out at that time.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you.
And also the earlier Budget Committee meetings we had, I think January or February, it was
November
even, it was brought up then. So it's been on our radar for a long time, and then it was approved. So this is just the formality piece to it to implement it, so with this ordinance. Okay, so that will be taken up at the next meeting. And next on the agenda is a resolution on page 86, and this is approving the vehicle lease contracts with Wireworks. So would Council have any questions, or would you like to have, I see a captain's in the back. Any questions?
Move adoption of the resolution.
Second.
Okay. All right, any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Okay, motion carried.
Always.
Okay, next is adoption of the consent calendar, and if there isn't any items that you'd like to have pulled off this evening, then I'll entertain a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. All right. Next is approval of an agreement, and this one is Kate. You gonna come up and chat about this one?
Good evening, Mayor and Councilors. The staff report for the approval of this agreement begins on page 94 of your packet, and this is bringing back the finalized intergovernmental agreement with Linn County for the new contractor position to market the Expo Center, as we discussed. And as I indicated in the staff report, the draft of the IGA was based on recommendations that came from Council. We put those together for you. It was reviewed by the city manager, the city attorney, and then went over to Linn County for their review. So this is the final draft for your review. At the bottom of the staff report in the budget impact section, I did make a note there at the last two paragraphs about where the funds for this new position could come from. This relates specifically to the line items. Our ad hoc TLT committee had recommended that the flat salary amount could come from the line item designated for collaborative tourism, and then should there be any commissions paid out, that could come from a reduction in the reserve line item in the the economic development fund.
And that was as we agreed when we talked about it at council before.
So, okay, when the council had discussed about this before moving in the direction, making the decision, moving the direction, it was really looking for performance measures and the metrics. So what was really put into the agreement to really show, is it just one booking? Do they have to have multiple bookings, or how is that?
So the agreement does not outline specific goals like that, but it does call for a quarterly review by you that'll be brought forward for you to see what he's done
every quarter and give us a report on what, where, who, why, and how.
Yeah, and then it is up to you. This is for a 1 year agreement, and it is renewable at your discretion based on that review of those metrics that he's bringing forward. But no, to your question, Mayor, it does not specifically outline what exactly those metrics are to be.
So then how can we really really know for that performance if we don't, you know, how can we question the performance if we don't really know, if we don't have it set down on paper of how many bookings they should be doing as like a minimum amount of bookings? Was there a discussion in crafting up the agreement towards that?
No, we did not get into the specifics and metrics when we crafted mm-hmm. this.
Yeah, Bill?
I think it would be somewhat subjective. You might think they're doing a great job, and somebody next to you says, I think we ought to cancel the agreement. I think that's probably part of the problem with trying to establish some matrix of performance. I have some concerns about this, to tell you the truth, but I'm willing to vote yes to try it for a year. The biggest thing for me is that we are going to get some reports, and a year from now, if we don't like it, we cancel it.
Mm-hmm. Bessie?
Okay, can you tell me what the starting date is? Because the commissioners approved it on May 19th. The guy gave a report last council meeting, and so when does this actually start? Was it July 1?
It actually is backdated. I believe in one of the exhibits in your packet is his contract with the county, and it was executed as of May 19th.
May 19th, okay.
Yeah.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any other questions? Okay, council, what would you like to do with this item?
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Okay, motion carried. All right, thank you, Kate. Next is appointments, and this is appointing Kim Brown and Ann Talop to the Library Board. Library Board is one that has their, they run by fiscal year for the terms for those positions. I'll entertain a motion.
I move we approve both nominations.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Okay, motion carried. Next is a report, and this is initiating the street vacation proceedings for 6th and Willetta. And that must be your item.
Good evening, Mayor, City Councilor. I'm Bob Richardson, Planning Division Manager, and here in front of you to request that the City Council initiate a street vacations for the new police and fire stations. As you know, city staff are working with McKenzie Architects to prepare required land use applications for both of these police and fire stations. Both projects require conditional use and replat approval permits, and they require the vacation of street rights of way. Staff requests that the City Council initiate street vacation proceedings and direct staff to prepare applications to vacate a portion of Willetta Street Southwest for the new police station and a portion of 6th Street Southeast between Baker and Lyon Streets for the new fire station. I have slides if anybody's interested in seeing that. Initiating the street vacations would facilitate coordination of the vacation applications with respective conditional use and replat applications. Please note that initiating the vacation proceedings is not a decision on the future vacation or conditional use and replat applications. However, it is recommended that any future decisions regarding the vacation applications be contingent upon approval of the conditional use applications. So I'll conclude that and take any questions you might have.
I do. Looking at the police lot, there must be some obvious reason, but we're not vacating all of Willetta on the property? Or is that where the property goes to? It looks like the Willetta is going to go into the lot.
Well, maybe David Martin now can answer, but I think that it goes all the way through to the end of the property line, and mm-hmm. and so it would stop at that point. And Is that your question, or that goes further through?
The yellow part, there's a notch.
Why the notch?
Oh, I see.
Why the notch?
I see. Yeah, and do you want to answer that, David? Yeah.
I'm David again, the planner upstairs. And the reason for that notch is that it preserves the ability to utilize some of the right-of-way at the northerly edge of Willetta Street for a cul-de-sac.
Okay.
That's the short answer.
Actually, if you wanted to see, I have a slide of that that shows it on the site plan.
They're going to build a house in there by any chance, are they? Is that the cul-de-sac you're talking about?
No, he's if the site plan, the conceptual site plan for the police station shows that where that notch is that Councillor Kellum was referring to at just at the beginning of Willetta Street, that is shown as a cul-de-sac that would be within the police station site. We've kind of been locked out.
Just space bar.
Just hit the enter key.
Any other questions?
I understand what.
Yeah, you understand.
What
okay.
A cul-de-sac looks like and where you've been.
So that's where potentially where some of the police could come out if necessary, right. off that
it's
cul-de-sac.
The back way, given yeah. Something other than normal.
Yeah.
Okay. But that would not be there normally.
No password. There you go.
Next slide.
There it is.
Where the blue arrow is, yep. Shows the cul-de-sac.
Oh, okay.
So people would be able to go in from Willetta and go around the front and come out on Pacific if they so desired under that scenario.
But the police chief has said they're going to all be going out on Pacific.
Okay. Any other questions of staff?
I move the requested action. Second.
Okay. Any other questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carried. Okay. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Okay, Council. That's it for our agenda and business from the Council. So was there anything, Bessie, this evening?
Nothing that I can think of.
Okay. Bill? No. Dick? Okay. Rich? Ray?
Small oversight. I was expecting to approve, propose a candidate for the Human Relations Commission and told the lady that it would be done this evening, but a miscue with me and staff, and so the application didn't make it into the packet, and so that'll happen next time.
You know what happened to that, Marilyn?
I don't.
Okay.
It just came in the mail, I believe, today. Maybe possibly
a couple,
yesterday.
A couple days ago,
okay.
From Laura.
Okay.
We communicated.
Okay.
Miscommunicated.
Anything else? Okay, Boyd.
I'm talking to the bridge contractor on North Albany Road. They're going to lay beams on Friday. So moving right along. That'll be a difference. Doesn't mean it's going to be open to traffic. Won't be open to pedestrians, but you got to lay the beams before you can build the road. They're making progress.
By the way, how's it been on the street in front of your house?
Busy.
Has it been trying to get out of your driveway?
No, it's not too bad.
Uh-huh.
You just have to time it quickly.
Yeah.
I do appreciate the efforts of APD and having the radar units out there. And staff was able to work with Benton County and got a temporary reduction on Spring Hill from 40 to 35. Which allows those side streets to have access to try to hit the gaps, and seems to be working reasonably well given we went from 2,000 vehicles a day to over probably 13 to 14,000 on Quarry.
Wow.
What's happening at the traffic circle, the oval about. Some people are happy, some people are not, but it's functioning reasonably well.
Did you give it
through
it?
No.
One thing I would comment on, I commented to ODOT at the MPO meeting, is I have had lots of comments about the citizens liking the dual left turn lanes from Spring Hill onto Highway 20. And I would encourage our staff to engage in negotiations with ODOT to see if we can keep those on a permanent basis.
Yeah, that'd be great. Okay.
That's all. Thank you.
And I didn't have anything this evening, so Jorge, Assistant City Manager, anything?
Actually, had a meeting with Fred, the new executive director for the COG, and we went over...
Abuseman.
And we went over some of the new transparency expenditure application, and they're very interested in us giving them a demo for the monthly meeting they have with the city managers and county managers. So we'll be doing that in the office.
Wonderful. That'd be great. Yeah. Thank you for meeting with Fred. Yes. Okay. Any other staff have anything this evening? So, yeah, Jeff?
One brief item. I received a call from City of Lebanon staff earlier this week. Their city manager is at the same event that Wes is at. So the city manager wanting to be there to have the discussion with the council about the canal, they're going to be holding their discussion on July 22nd instead of tonight. So it'll be a little bit longer till we hear back, still positive feedback from Lebanon staff at this point. So we'll report back once we hear more after that meeting.
Oh, great. Okay. All right. Okay. Anything else? All right. We have a work session for July 20th and regular session is for July 22nd. And I think all of you did receive the email that Kara next week, board has been canceled. So with that, we are adjourned.